Good morning and welcome everyone to this RFF live event, Environmental Justice, Climate Impacts, Adaptation and Resilience. This is the third in a six-part series on environmental justice co-sponsored with the Urban Institute. I'm Margaret Walls, Senior Fellow at RFF, and I'm joined by my colleague and co-organizer of the series, Carlos Martin, who's a Senior Fellow at the Urban Institute. Thanks so much for joining us. So for those of you, just quickly, who aren't familiar with RFF, we're an independent nonprofit research institution based in Washington, D.C., and our mission is to improve environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement.
And the Urban Institute is also a nonpartisan research organization based in Washington. We are focused on social and economic outcomes and the use of data, evidence, and facts to inform policy. So Urban's environmental justice work in particular uses both our traditional analytical lenses, as well as community-based research and work with environmental justice advocates and activists, some of which you're going to hear from today.
Yep. So we always like to start these by explaining what three goals we have in mind with the EJ webinar series. So the first is to educate and inform our audiences about research on various aspects of environmental justice and the important intersections between research policy and advocacy. The second objective is to bring together EJ advocates who work at the grassroots level and often have intimate knowledge of the nature of problems in EJ communities, with researchers who often are equipped with methodological tools and data to analyze the problems. And so by doing this, we hope to enrich the dialogue around the issues and ultimately improve research policy and outcomes. And third, we're trying to identify remaining gaps in knowledge and important paths forward for policy, especially at this time where both the climate crisis and racial reckoning are finally becoming national policy priorities in the United States.
And this is our third event today. Our last event was on energy justice. So today we will take a deeper look at the issues of climate justice, paying particular attention to the impacts of climate change and issues of climate adaptation. This includes temperature extremes, flooding, sea level rise, and natural hazards, as well as adaptation, hazard mitigation, and recovery. So the impacts of climate change, as we all know and hopefully understand today, often hit low-income neighborhoods and communities of color particularly hard. Governmental policies can exacerbate these problems because investments in hazard mitigation and the disbursement of disaster aid often disproportionately benefit wealthier and whiter households and neighborhoods. This panel will discuss research in this area, grassroots activities that are helping communities cope, and some of the policy challenges and solutions.
So we're honored, really honored, to have four fantastic experts in today's discussion. So let me take a moment to introduce them. Sonal Jessel is the Director of Policy at We Act for Environmental Justice out of New York City, where she's responsible for advancing local, state, and national policy agendas. And in addition, she's led We Act's Northern Manhattan Climate Action Plan, which we're going to hear a little bit about today. Dr. Erthia Nance is Associate Professor at Texas Southern University, where she holds joint faculty appointments in the Department of Urban Planning and Environmental Policy in the Barbara Jordan Mickey Leland School of Public Affairs and the Department of Political Science. Dr. Nance is also a certified floodplain manager, a board-licensed civil engineer, and a former public official in New Orleans during the city's recovery from Hurricane Katrina. We're also joined by Dr. Carolyn Kuski. Carolyn is Executive Director at the Wharton Risk Management and Decision Processes Center at the University of Pennsylvania, where she also directs the policy incubator and conducts research on disaster insurance, disaster finance, and climate risk management. Carolyn is also currently the Vice Chair of the California Climate Insurance Working Group under California Insurance Commissioner Ricardo Lara, and happily for me, a university fellow here at RFF. And finally, we have Dr. Eric Tate. Eric is Associate Professor of Geographical and Sustainability Sciences at the University of Iowa. He conducts research on social vulnerability indicators and equity in relation to hazard mitigation and recovery, particularly in relation to climate-related hazards such as hurricanes and floods. Dr. Tate serves on the advisory board of the Anthropocene Alliance and is co-chair of the National Academy's Resilient America Roundtable. So welcome to all four of you. We're so happy to have you here. Let me just go through a couple few housekeeping notes quickly for our audience. This is a public webinar. It's being recorded and it will be posted on the RFF website afterward. As time allows, we'll be opening up the webinar to audience Q&A at the end of the session. All audience members are muted, so we encourage you to submit your questions to the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen. Feel free to enter those questions at any point in the webinar. We'll be monitoring them, and we'll try to get to as many as possible towards the end of the discussion. And lastly, if you'd like to join the conversation on Twitter, please use the hashtag RFFLive. And so with that, let me pass it over to Carlos, who's going to begin the conversation.
Great. Thanks, Margaret. Let's get started right away. And let's first start off by talking about what we know about vulnerability, climate vulnerability in particular, and the distribution of impacts from weather extremes, be they hurricanes, inland, tidal flooding, heat waves, et cetera. So what does the research and the facts on the ground tell us? I'll begin with you, Dr. Tate. One lesson that climate researchers are calling from disaster scholarship has been the idea of hazard vulnerability. So we're borrowing the idea of work that you've done and colleagues of yours on hazard vulnerability and thinking about it in terms of in the climate context, both as distinct vulnerability, as distinct from risk and exposure. So you worked on hazard vulnerability. Can you tell us a bit about what factors are encompassed in hazard vulnerability and what we know about who is bearing the brunt of disasters, and then maybe share your thoughts about whether that's the same for climate vulnerability?
Yeah, sure. You talked about risk and exposure. Just brief primer here. So risk is about the consequences associated with specific hazard events of a certain, you know, likelihood. It's often measured in economic terms. Exposure is about people and structures that are located in hazard zones. And these are usually what's focused on. Vulnerability, by contrast, is about the susceptibility of people in these places. And what we understand, it's a pre-existing condition. It's not created by disasters, but it's revealed by them and it's amplified by disasters. Now, who's most vulnerable? Some populations persistently face greater impacts from extreme weather hazards. And this varies by place and stage of disaster, but it generally includes people living in poverty with chronic health problems at age extremes, racial and ethnic minorities, renters, and recent immigrants. Now, in terms of climate vulnerability, there's some overlap there, but I think it's more complex with climate vulnerability and also brings more attention to the chronic nature of these hazards. I would say that sort of interactions, you know, with climate vulnerability, it starts to bring in interactions with things like biodiversity loss and food scarcity and water scarcity and land degradation. So, it just becomes much more complex.
The point that you make about geographic specificity, about the place and the social context in which people are, in which these vulnerabilities develop, I think is really important. And so I would like to toss the same question to Ms. Giselle. I'd like to get your reaction about this notion of vulnerability and the specificities. And given your work in communities in New York, does this resonate with you?
Yeah, I really agree with Dr. Tate's definition and description. I think he put it really, really well. I think, you know, we act as a community-based organization. We work with members. We work with people that live in Harlem, Washington Heights, and Inwood in New York City. Often there are low-income people or people of color. That's who we really focus our interventions and our work on. And we found that generally vulnerability comes in a lot of different ways and is, in fact, the vulnerability is something that exists before an extreme weather event or some type of event happens. And it's also a very layered thing where people who are vulnerable to extreme heat or hurricanes or flooding are also vulnerable to housing insecurity and financial insecurity and food insecurity and getting all the medicines that they need. And so when I think of vulnerability, I think of it as this very, very layered thing where the same people who are vulnerable for one type of hardship are probably vulnerable for the other one too. And that sort of the nature of how vulnerability is created and how it is, becomes something that people have is due to their built environment, due to systematic and institutional racist practices, due to all of these types of systems that have deprived people of the things that they need, or just haven't invested in certain communities and certain places to keep people safe or get people prepared for any kind of climate change impact. And that includes rebuilding and rebuilding after some type of climate event happens as well.
That's a pretty good segue into our next set of questions. And I think what we want to do is turn to policy. So government policy plays a really big role in all of this, especially when it comes to flooding and disaster assistance. So I think we're going to talk about flood insurance, and then we're going to talk about disaster assistance and other government policies. So let's start with flood insurance. And first, let me just set the stage to make sure most of our audience members may know this, but your general homeowners and renters insurance policies do not cover damage from flooding. So for that kind of coverage, you need to purchase flood insurance. And that's offered through the National Flood Insurance Program, or the NFIP, which is run by the federal government. So if you own a home in a designated special flood hazard area, or what's often referred to as the 100-year floodplain, and you have a federally backed mortgage, you are required to have flood insurance, but the mandate's not always strictly enforced, and many, many people who live in the floodplain do not have flood insurance. So Dr. Kuski, I consider you my go-to person on the NFIP. You're really an expert in this and all things flood insurance. So it's my understanding first that the best way for a household to recover after a flood is with insurance. Those households who have insurance recover faster and more fully. And FEMA is really putting a high priority on closing what they call the flood insurance gap for this reason. So first, I want to ask you, indeed, is this true about insurance and recovery? And second, can you just tell us a little bit about what we know about who tends to purchase flood insurance, and what are some of the factors that explain why people don't purchase it? Why do we have so many people without insurance?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Margaret. And you're exactly right. There's now a growing body of research that indicates that those with insurance tend to recover better and recover faster. And also that having the funds in order to make your home safe again and make the necessary repairs has also been shown to be linked to other aspects of well-being, like improved mental and physical health outcomes. It prevents households from having to make difficult and often harmful trade-offs in order to have the sufficient funds. So for example, if you don't have your money to make your home safe again, you might have to divert funds away from other important expenditures, or you might have to use up whatever small amount you've saved for something else, or you might have to run up debt that becomes really hard to repay. So, you know, because of this, insurance really does increase financial resilience. And that's because, at least here in the US, there's really no substitute to insurance for having the financial resources to recover. So there's essentially four big sources of money to pay for the cost of a disaster, which, and we've looked at some of the FEMA damage assessments, you know, a really severe disaster can cause thousands, tens of thousands. If it completely destroys a home, like it's burned to the ground or whatever, right? You could have hundreds of thousands of dollars in damage. So how do you pay? And that's just the property damage, I should say, right? There's also myriad other expenses that are imposed on families after disasters. So where do you get the funds to cover these? There's essentially four sources, right? You can use up your savings. You could take out a loan, right? Access to credit. You could get aid or assistance from the government or from a charitable group or others, or insurance. And the problem is that unfortunately many households, and especially lower income households, struggle with access to any of these. So most households don't have sufficient savings to cover all those costs that we just talked about. Loans are typically the first line of defense for disaster victims in the US, but research has shown that over half of applicants to our disaster loan program are denied because they don't meet debt to income or credit score requirements. So this tends to hurt lower income households the most. And in this disaster loan program, we've actually found that the share of applicants denied credit increases as income declines, right? But for the lowest income households, they might not be able to repay the debt anyway. So it's really not a solution for those families. And that's not to say that credit isn't a solution for others. It can play an important role in recovery. So that brings us back to disaster aid, and I think we'll unpack this a little bit more maybe later on, but in quick summary, let's just say it's insufficient and typically takes way too long to get to people. So that leaves insurance. But those who need insurance the most are the least able to afford it. So that brings us now to the flood insurance program, and Margaret, you mentioned some of their goals to try to increase take-up. FEMA has done some analysis and found that affordability, just simply being unable to afford the cost of flood insurance, is one reason, and a big reason why households might not purchase flood insurance. Historically, the NFIP has provided discounts on flood insurance that were irrespective of need, but there's now a policy proposal in Congress, I should say, and one that's been advocated for by many stakeholders of this program for years now, to instead provide means-tested assistance so that those who need help with the costs of insurance can have access to that financial resilience, but we don't sort of artificially suppress rates for everyone.
Right. So is this, Carolyn, part of the reforms that FEMA has underway in the form of risk rating 2.0? Can you tell us a little bit about that? And I know also that you yourself have been working on the concept of what you've termed inclusive insurance, a term that gets used, as I understand it, a lot in developing countries. Maybe you can talk about that too and tell us if it might work in the U.S.?
Yeah. So FEMA is rolling out this new approach to rate setting, and just as a quick aside, it's really a long overdue modernization of the way FEMA sets prices. It'll make insurance prices more accurately reflect flood risk at a property level and take account of all sources of flood risk, including rainfall-related flooding, which is getting worse with climate change and is not typically in FEMA maps. But for our topic today, it also undoes this regressive cross-subsidy that's currently built into the way the NFIP prices policies from low-valued homes paying too much and high valued homes paying too little. So let me try to kind of explain it. I think it's best by thinking through a stylized example. So consider a $100,000 home and a $1 million home, and they both buy $100,000 of flood coverage. Well, the chance that the NFIP pays a $100,000 flood claim to the $100,000 home is very, very low, because that would mean that the flood had completely destroyed the entire house, right? So that's not going to happen that often. But the chance that the NFIP pays a $100,000 claim to the $1 million home is much greater, because that would only be 10% of the home being damaged, which would happen in a much more frequent type of flooding. So it's riskier, and paying claims is more likely for the $1 million home. So insurance pricing should take account of that. And indeed, the private sector does this. If when you buy homeowners insurance, the value of your home and the amount of that value that you choose to insure influence the price, but the NFIP has not done this. So the extent to which you think that lower income people tend to be in lower valued homes and higher income people tend to be in higher valued homes, this was regressive pricing within the flood insurance program. And that's now being changed under risk rating 2.0, which is one of the reasons I think it's important that it be allowed to proceed, because it will make rates not only more accurate, but also more equitable. But now to your second point, that doesn't really solve the problem. Disaster insurance is fundamentally expensive. And even when we undo some of these kind of perverse pricing things, it's still going to be too expensive for some people. And it would be great, in my personal opinion, if Congress passed, you know, some sort of means-tested assistance program to help with it. They haven't done that yet. So in the sort of face of sort of limited congressional activity on this, we've been looking at how the private sector could maybe help open up insurance to those typically locked out of insurance because of affordability. And like you said, globally, that's often referred to as inclusive insurance. So I'll try to be really fast. One model we've been looking at is something called parametric microinsurance. So in the US, when you suffer a loss, you know, someone has to come and look at your house and tell you how much money you get, and you get the amount of your damage, right? And that's really costly to do that, because you have to pay the adjuster and everything. Instead, with parametric insurance, you get money right away based on a measure of the disaster, like wind speed within so many miles of your house. This makes it a lot cheaper, which lowers the cost. Also, there's been a bunch of, you know, different ways that companies are harnessing technology to make costs lower. And then when you add on this idea of microinsurance, which essentially is like a lower coverage limit and a lower premium, you can basically open up insurance coverage for a whole bunch of people who might not otherwise have been able to afford it. And it's not a replacement for when you need like full indemnity homeowners coverage, but it does provide really fast and really flexible dollars that can improve recovery, like for renters, those in mobile homes, as an add-on to insurance, or just to provide base coverage when other options are too expensive. So yeah, we've been looking at a bunch of those models.
So exploring those inequities in insurance, both private and public supported insurance programs, I think is so critical, Carolyn, and thinking through ways to eliminate the potential for human bias. And by human bias, we mean racism, classism, a variety of different strategies that are used when assessing people's properties and people's livelihoods, right? And so I think insurance is one important part of the way injustices continue to amass for so many of these communities. I want to talk about one of the other four buckets that you mentioned, and that's specifically direct federal aid, which of course in the United States happens almost exclusively after a disaster rather than in planning, though I do want to note that the Biden administration's proposal to increase the FEMA BRIC program for mitigation and infrastructure before hazard. But the whole idea of crisis and recovery being the mindset brings two other problems, I think. And one is that it is focused on rebuilding quickly, and that's regardless of whether what existed before was even desirable or suitable or equitable. And then two, that this is notoriously inequitable, particularly for the most vulnerable poor and BIPOC households whose housing, property, and possessions are undervalued and who suffer the longest term financial, health, and employment losses after a specific hazard event. And they often have the fewest resources to apply for and wait for aid from the FEMA individual assistance all the way through the backstop of CDBG, HUD's Community Development Block Grant for Disaster Recovery. So I'd like to turn to Dr. Nance to start talking about, because of your experiences with so many hazard events, post-hazard recovery scenarios from New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina and after Hurricane Harvey in Houston in 2017. You were part of the Greater Houston Flood Mitigation Consortium, for example, and the Harris County Commissioner's Court appointed you to the Community Flood Resilience Task Force, which is working to ensure that the county develops and implements equitable flood resilience planning and projects. I recall a New York Times article this past year citing the dispersion of these funds in which you were cited. So let's talk a little bit about what this audience should understand about how the federal government's disaster assistance programs work and why there are inherent inequities in those programs.
You're muted, or Dr. Nance.
Thank you, Carlos. You summarized those problems very well. There are so many problems with the federal program, an untold number, and there's also a lot of studies, many publications, including my own, that describe the details of how that happens. So I want to just take some of those problems and give a little bit of more examples of them. So the federal programs are not designed for communities, they are designed for states. The reality on the ground is not, you know, it's assumed that it trickles through the city and then it trickles through the state, and the state is actually the community. So the rules that exist at the federal level don't incorporate local realities, especially the reality in marginalized areas. The state can change the federal rules if they want to in how they implement them. They can't really change the federal rules, but they have discretion in how they implement those federal rules. They can make changes. They can delay or slow down payments to certain cities if they want to. And this has happened. Those delays increase the cost of construction when you're after disaster and you're trying to construct. The cost of construction is going up. So all of those delays increase the cost and therefore, you know, reduce how many people can get served with the same amount of money. The state can create competing programs of its own, competing with the city trying to implement the federal programs. And worst of all, the state can work positively against a city. And this, if you think about New Orleans, and if you think about Puerto Rico, where either the feds or the state was literally stalling. And I was in charge of hazard mitigation in New Orleans after Katrina, and the use of discretion by the officials at the state level to stop our recovery was unbelievable. In fact, I even wrote in this document, which I'll make available for practitioners, all of the things they did to me to stop me from implementing mitigation in New Orleans. I wrote an article. It was so hard to find a place to publish this because nobody talks about, from the practitioner's viewpoint, what's being done to you so that you cannot pass those funds through. So for example, every time I was trying to get over the benefit cost, that's a real blockage. And so I would mix rich and poor homes together in a package for wind mitigation and for a buyout and or for elevation. I would mix them together and I put packages of about $10 million in a package and send them to the state. And I had a group of three people from FEMA helping me to put those packages together because of the capacity problem. So I figured, well, I've got FEMA with me. It doesn't get any better than that. Everything was denied every time. And so I'm like, okay, why are you denying? I have FEMA here. What's the problem? Well, this $12 million package was off by $2. okay, let's find that $2. It's rounding error. You know, put it in again. Oh, denied again. It's off by $1 this time. And then, you know, it's so frustrating because, you know, people are dying. And I, you know, got it down to the zero. And even then, it's denied. And I just, out of frustration, what's going on here? And they said, well, you know, the state does not accept Excel.
As a software format.
As a software program. So I call my counterpart in Jefferson Parish. Okay, what are you doing? How are you getting the money? Because everything you do is approved. Or Thea, look, I'm going to fax you my application. You do exactly what I do and it'll go through. So I do that. Years go by. It's finally approved. But years went by. So this is what I'm talking about. How do you even, it's not just benefit cost, although benefit cost is a whole nother problem. That's a discriminatory problem that is literally a social problem in and of itself. I learned about this benefit cost problem back in the early 90s when I was a grad student at Stanford. That was 30 years ago. It's like climate change. We knew about it years ago and we did nothing. That's the same thing. I could go on and on about these things. But what's going on in Houston, now that I'm in Houston, in 2018, 85% of the voters who voted passed a $2.5 billion bond after Hurricane Harvey for recovery. And the words equitable distribution of resources were written in, that there had to be some way of prioritizing. So those who were always discriminated against and marginalized, they would also be able to recover. Soon after that, Lena Hidalgo was elected judge, also a Stanford grad and a rising star. She was elected and there was a fight over how to do the prioritization of that money. Basically, because she had, a majority on the commissioner's court, she won. She also, this was a very public fight. It's in the newspapers. She said things like some areas of the city would never see a project without these guidelines. So we have areas in Houston and Harris County that have not even received maintenance for over 30 years. So the equity issue is really, really important. And long story short, it was voted on that we'd have to use the social vulnerability index to prioritize projects. A priority list was put together. Everything is rolling. We are assuming that they're doing what we, you know, the voters said to do and what was written down. We find out in March of this year that it turned out that they had tied all of the money that was for marginalized areas, they tied that to unreliable federal matching funds, which didn't come through. And so they had used the money that had no strings attached, they'd used it in the same areas that had always received. So there was outrage, and this was national news. The commissioner's court told the head of flood control, by June, you have to give us a report on how you're gonna fix this problem. And the head of flood control resigned on Sunday. His report is due, I think it's June 29th, and his last day is just a couple days after that. So we don't have a lot of hope for what's coming. But this is the kind of discretion that local engineers can have that just sideline, you can get the policy right. You can have the money. You can have the politics. You voted for it. You needed it. Everything was in line, but discretion ruined everything for that whole side of the city. I'm gonna stop there. I could go on, but I'm gonna stop. I hope I answered.
You did, and the levels of complexities that you're addressing all belie the challenges that are ahead of us in terms of making sure that these processes are transparent. And I think particularly the issue around the governance from federal government through state government, through county and city level government, down to actual communities and neighborhoods and decision-making processes. So all of these, we haven't even talked about community engagement of making people involved in the decision-making processes associated with the governmental plans. But I do want to continue this conversation about the specifics of federal programs. So you've talked about some of the mitigation programs that are available after the fact. I want to talk a little bit more about the federal government property buyout program, because I know Dr. Tate has done significant research on property buyouts and disasters and inequities. So buying out properties and moving people out of harm's ways can have long-term benefits, both for those households and for communities, if people are willing and able to move. As colleagues of ours, including Dr. Tate at National Resource Defense Council, have shown, these processes are often lengthy, meaning only people with the patience and the resources to wait for the aid and for the buyout actually benefit from them. So Dr. Tate, what did your research show about these kinds of programs?
Yeah, so I think property buyouts or voluntary property acquisition, I think they definitely make sense from a high level. You know, a principal reason why we have ever increasing flood impacts in this country is because we keep building in floodplains. And buyouts are somewhat of a counter to that, and removing buildings and restricting future development in these places. And buyout programs certainly do well from a benefit cost ratio perspective, which is, you know, it's a leading measure for prioritizing federal funding. And my research after the 2008 floods in Iowa bears this out. But there's also an expanding breadth and depth of research in the areas of buyouts and managed retreat for climate change by folks like A.R. Siders and Jim Elliott, Miyuki Hino. And it's showing that the social implications of buyouts are a lot more complicated. So applying a social lens, essentially buyouts are a policy that benefits single family homeowners and communities that have the capacity to apply and manage these buyout programs. As a result, you know, increasing research is showing that buyouts are a resource that benefit wider and wealthier communities. We don't have much understanding of the varied experiences of buyout participants and their neighborhoods, both in the short and the long term. There's a lot we don't know because we primarily looked at this from an economic standpoint and an environmental standpoint.
Yeah, let's talk to Dr. Kuski about some of these issues. I understand that you and your team at Wharton did some work with Carlos and his colleagues at Urban developing what you call a digital dialogue on low-income families and disaster recovery. And one thing you've noted is the wide gamut of needs after a disaster and the range of federal services that in theory could meet those needs. So can you tell us a little bit more about that? And if climate justice intends to address an even wider range of needs, what kind of federal services might be in order?
Yeah, sure, thanks. It was wonderful to work with Carlos and the Urban Institute on this because they've done such fantastic work on this topic. But we basically teamed up and asked about a dozen experts on how federal disaster programs could be improved to better meet the needs of low-income households. I should say, if anyone's interested, the answers are now posted on both our websites. But I also want to note that the responses and probably the way we framed the question were more focused on the structure of these programs at the federal level and didn't get as much into those incredibly problematic issues that Dr. Nance just talked about with sort of implementation, which are also deeply in need of reform. So I think we have issues sort of at many levels of scale here. You know, but as others have mentioned, right now our federal programs are not really helping fill in the gaps and provide the needed support for lots of households. There's many programs across many different agencies. It's difficult and confusing to navigate them. This slows recovery and has now been mentioned by several of us. You know, the sort of research on this is now finding that they're distributed really inequitably, even when maybe that wasn't necessarily the program's intent. That has been the outcome of many of these. So I think it's important to note to start, federal assistance is only provided right for those most severe disaster events. And we're seeing lots of localized events that can still be really harmful for families, but don't even rise to the level of getting any federal assistance at all. And then when federal assistance comes, it's often insufficient and really delayed. Maybe the most well-known program would be FEMA's individual assistance grants. But the average grant, I think, is only a few thousand dollars. And I think it's maybe less well known that those grants are only to make homes safe and habitable, not bring them back to pre-disaster conditions. So they really don't begin to meet all the needs after a disaster. And has been indicated, research is showing that those dollars tend to flow to higher income areas and whiter areas. And FEMA is now trying to take a serious look at how to improve the equity of its programs because of these findings. For the very worst disasters, Congress might also send money through HUD in the form of block grants. But as research that the Urban Institute pioneered, that those grants can take like years, literally years, before the dollars are spent in communities. So they really don't meet people's immediate needs after a disaster. And a lot of our programs tend to focus on property destruction, right? But we've talked about how many disadvantaged communities suffer from all these other costs, right? Transportation that's offline, power that's really slow to be restored. Maybe there's environmental pollution spills. Maybe there's schools without sufficient resources to make the needed repairs. Maybe there's not enough affordable long-term rental housing. And to be fair, there are other disaster and non-disaster programs that maybe get less attention, but are still really important in helping with the recovery process, like disaster unemployment and disaster supplemental nutrition assistance. And we had experts weigh in on these too. But I think across the board, there's like lots of reform that people think needs to be had to make them more useful. And now, as you know, with climate worsening, extreme events, we really need to prioritize our investments in risk reduction so that we can lower, you know, these costs ahead of time and protect people ahead of time, particularly in frontline communities. Just one policy note, recently, this administration has increased the amount of money through a new FEMA program that's trying to invest more in pre-disaster mitigation called their BRIC program. But I think we're probably going to need more specific climate adaptation programs too going forward.
Right. So thanks, Dr. Kuski. Ms. Jessel, can you tell us a little bit more, speak to these things from your work at WEACT? Like, what are some of the problems we might not fully understand when we're not on the ground experiencing it ourselves? And maybe you have thoughts about how the federal government can do better. And I'd like to specifically, we've talked a lot about flooding, but I know a lot of your work there is around urban heat island problems and extreme heat events. So maybe you want to say something about that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, one thing that I'm thinking about a lot as everyone's making their comments is just also the simple fact that communities live in a certain place and maybe have been there for a really long time. And what is the sort of psychosocial and mental health impacts of having to move and relocate? And does that mean your community is split up? Does that mean you have to live in different places? Like, what does that do to people, to families, to communities? Is something that I think is just generally, I think it's getting better, but it's not as well researched in terms of the implication of disaster response as much. So that's one thing I'm thinking of that, based on what everyone else has been saying, is very true, very real. And, you know, even the different research I've read from a lot of extreme weather events, I think it was mostly hurricanes. So, you know, people didn't leave their homes because they didn't want to risk losing their valuables, or they didn't want to risk losing their home because they felt like it was going to get taken from them if they left. And a lot of that comes from sort of, for people of color, a lot of that comes from lack of trust in government to take care of you, and thinking, you know, you have to take care of yourself. And I think that's a very valid feeling that people have. And so that's sort of another thing that I think about a lot. There's a lot of nuance to how to prepare people for disaster and work with people during and after. And then, yeah, we do a lot of work on extreme heat. We have what's called our Heat, Health, and Equity Initiative. And this is responding to a major growing concern amongst our community members that extreme heat has gotten worse because of climate change, which we know that to be completely true. And with the added issue that we are in a city, a big city with lots of tall buildings and cars and a lot of concrete everywhere, not a lot of trees and greenery. We have the urban heat island effect, where it's much, much, much hotter in our city than it is out in sort of the other parts of New York State, for example. And heat is actually the number one weather-related killer in the United States, but we don't talk about it. People refer to it as the silent killer because it doesn't get talked about as much. It's not as visually clear that that's what's happening. People are just dying from heat stroke, or they go to the emergency room or go to the hospital or pass away because of a illness that was made worse by heat, but it was considered because they had a heart attack or they had an asthma attack or something like that. So when we record that information and look at that data, it doesn't say it's because of heat that this happened. So it's very hard to also just track how many people are impacted by heat, and it takes some like retrospective research to figure that out. And so this is a major issue. We find in New York City, The last time this was looked at overarchingly, we found that over a 10-year period of time, 50% of the deaths were Black and African American people in New York City, even though they make up only about a quarter of the population. So we know there's a huge disparity in what's happening for people. And a lot of that comes down to their built environment. What is the type of home you live in? What is your building envelope? How well is your home staying cool? Are you able to cool your home down? Do you have access to an air conditioner? Can you turn it on? Can you afford the bill that comes as a result of that, which is a major barrier? A lot of research has found that Black and African American households have much higher utility bill costs than white households in comparison across the United States. And so this is a major issue around how people can prepare for the disaster that is a heat wave and be sort of stay safe during that disaster as well. And a lot of that comes down to home cooling. And so one thing that we work really a lot on is the Federal Home Energy Assistance Program. It provides aid to states and states decide how to allocate that within certain parameters. And in New York State, this program does not pay for utility bills in the summertime. It pays for utility bills in the wintertime. And in the summer, all it does is pay for someone to get an AC unit or a fan. And what we found over and over again is that A, people don't know about this program. There's really low utilization. People just are not signing up for it. And it's very clunky to sign up for. It's a long forms. Even last summer, it was really hard to get your hands on some of the forms. People that don't have internet or don't have a printer at home have to find other ways to fill them out. You can go to a local office, but last summer, at least it was closed. This summer, they're open again, thankfully. So it's actually just hard to apply. And then thirdly, it doesn't pay for the cost that you need to actually stay cool in your home and run your AC. We have community members that have told me their monthly bill in the summer is $300, $400 a month, which is completely unaffordable and leads to really long-term repercussions of not being able to pay your utility bill. And so this is what we work on because we want that assistance program to pay for people's utility bills as a short-term direct response to the extreme weather event that is a heat wave. Long-term, we wanna see low-income households be equipped to deal with extreme heat in a more sustainable way, in a way that's not contributing to the climate crisis at the same time. So that's really what we're working on in terms of extreme heat. And the last thing I'll say about this is that I consider extreme heat something that just is a risk multiplier. People that are dealing with other issues, extreme heat just makes it worse. COVID was a perfect example, is a perfect example of that. People that are at risk for COVID-19 are also at more risk for the health impacts of extreme heat. People that are dealing with housing insecurity have trouble affording their ACs and turning their ACs on or live in an apartment that doesn't allow it, whatever it might be. So heat is very much a risk multiplier of the issues that people are already dealing with.
Yeah, thank you for talking about that. I'm going to kind of segue back, I think, a little bit to the flooding, but I know there, beyond the federal policies and aid that we've been talking about, there's many structural problems in our society across institutions and layers of government that contribute to the inequities from extreme weather events. So Dr. Nance, you and I want to ask you kind of a little different sort of a question. You and I worked together on a National Science Foundation proposal that was focused on bringing social inequity concerns more explicitly into infrastructure decisions, especially to help communities adapt to climate change. And these would include decisions about like levees, stormwater infrastructure, and a host of other things. And a big piece of your thinking was about the engineering profession and education of engineers to do better in sort of incorporating these concerns. Can you just say a little bit more about this? And I would note for our audience that both you and Dr. Tate and Carlos as well, I believe, are trained as engineers. So you have PhDs in engineering, and yet you're both sort of in different disciplines in your research career. So I might ask Dr. Tate to also offer some observations about the role of engineers in adaptation.
Thank you for the question. This has been an issue that I've been interested in my entire career. You know, why is it that if you're an engineer, you know, you're supposed to set aside real analysis of equity and the depth that you do on the pipes and the pumps? Why can't the equity be included? When you don't serve a certain neighborhood, why isn't that disinvestment later analyzed and the cumulative impacts that you have helped create not ever counted? So there's just these accumulating factors that really create some of the problems that we've been talking about that engineers are trained not to even think about. And I noticed that when I was 27 and I was working as an engineer, working in a fantastic company, but equity was off the table. It was never discussed. It was never part of anything. And once I realized that, I had to go back to school and get re-educated. And I took a lot of social science, a lot of anthropology, Latin American studies, and I balanced out my brain. You know, the left and the right side are two different ways of thinking. And I balanced that out, but it took effort. I had to unlearn some of what I had been trained. I'm still good with numbers. That doesn't change. But the approach, the stance that you take, and what you decide to count and not count, that's what changes. And I think that an entire revolution needs to happen in engineering. I've thought that for a long time. And if anybody's going to start the revolution, I will sign up and help. Because the unlearning process, I'm telling you, we are battling with people that are in a system. They're working in that system and think that that's correct. And people are dying. And they're seeing it and not connecting the two.
Dr. Tate, do you have one, add anything to that?
Yeah,
what do you think?
This sort of awakening, I had a similar thing, right? So I don't have a PhD in engineering. I have bachelor's and master's.
Okay.
But I also worked as a consultant for about 10 years. And ultimately, I came to understand, like through Katrina mostly, that disasters are ultimately about people. But from an engineering perspective, it's about the water and the damage to stuff, right? And that's a predominant perspective. And it's also kind of viewed as a superior perspective. So, you know, infrastructure is really important for protecting people, but we don't tend to ask questions about like who, right? Who can evacuate, not just what's the road capacity and shelter capacity, whose homes are bought out, who's protected by dams and levees, not just how much flow is reduced or how much acres are protected. And so because we don't ask this question, you know, this is not part of education for engineers. It's not part of the practice. It's no surprise that these social disparities continue because it's just part of how our society is structured. So I think we need a lot more. I agree. It's like this fundamental shift in how we educate students, how we conduct research, how we design policies for allocating resources, because right now there's just simply no requirements to have that kind of knowledge to be a really successful engineer. And if we don't make these changes, you know, things like environmental justice and equity are gonna likely to remain peripheral issues. And the disparities that we see are likely to perpetuate.
So I would certainly say that there's a reckoning that's occurring in the engineering professions. And I'm going to defend the engineering professions for us just for a second. Just to note, I think part of that, and I do want to make sure that we reference the fact that there is a discussion right now about what actually is included in the built environment, particularly with regard to infrastructure and viewing housing as part of our nation's infrastructure is a critical component of that. But I think that there's a myth in our engineering training of neutrality and fairness, right? That Eric was referencing, that this idea that, well, as engineers, we're dealing with just the physicalities of our environment. So by definition, it's neutral. So that makes me recall a comment that Dr. Nance made about Judge Hidalgo's comments after the Harris County Flood Control District investments with regard to historical disadvantage, right? Because if we're engineers, we're thinking about equality and fairness in allocations when that is not intergenerational equity. It is not justice, right? It does not account for past histories of disinvestments and disenfranchisement. So justice isn't well-defined in policy, let alone practice. But low-income communities and low-income households of color and historically disinvested and structurally disadvantaged communities sure know what injustice and inequity looks like. So I'm gonna turn to Ms. Jeff Soule again to talk about how your work in New York bridges some of these gaps between what the vision of equity is and the reality of trying to get it done. I'm particularly looking at the Northern Manhattan Climate Action Plan, if you could talk about that just real quickly.
Yeah, I mean, I think you make really good points. I think that there's a lot of people that work in policy or work in sort of a lot of industries that are contributing to the discussion about climate change that have their own definitions of equity and justice that a lot of times as an environmental justice organization, we disagree with, or we think that's not very like going very far. You know, you're doing the bare minimum. You know, sometimes I feel like the term equity is now just thrown around everywhere without it really being well thought out. But for us, I think the Northern Manhattan Climate Action Plan is really our shining example of what we think is the best way to plan for climate change, which was and I think it was about 2015, had a community-led planning process for climate change is here, what do we do? That was like really what we asked. It was very open-ended. We took people through a lot of simulations and discussions, and it was a major project. And this all came out of the fear and the destruction that from Hurricane Sandy in 2012. And I think a lot of people, I personally wasn't around for that myself, but as we act as an organization, really jumped into gear with like, our communities are hit first and worst. We just saw it again, you know, and Hurricane Sandy was a major impact for a lot of the people, like East Harlem, for example, flooded, you know, many avenues in Central Harlem as well as a flood zone. North Inwood is a flood zone, not to mention so many other parts of New York City that are predominantly inhabited by lower income people that got flooded, including a lot of public housing buildings. Like East Harlem, there's a huge stretch of blocks that is just public housing. And so this Northern Manhattan Climate Action Plan is a culmination of talking to people in the community. What are the issues? We now do a lot of work around energy democracy because basically people said, I hate that Con Ed turned my power off and I couldn't do anything about it. And I was without power for forever. Meanwhile, this other part of New York City that's wealthier had their power turned on. What gives? And issues like that kept on being the discussion, like they're saying they want to have a more of a say and more, pun intended, power over where their energy comes from. And that led us to the pillar of energy democracy that we now do a lot of work within, which is people should have control over where they get their energy, where their energy is sourced, and how they use it. And so now we do a lot of work around installing solar panels in New York City, around community solar and getting people signed up for community solar. And a lot of this type of work we've seen from examples in other places, like there's a great example in Puerto Rico that a building that has solar on it ended up being a hub in a disaster in a hurricane that actually had power when other parts of the island did not. So we view this also as something that helps increase our sort of resilience as a community to have what you need to stay healthy. If you're dependent on power for medical devices, for example, you don't want that to be turned off at any point in time, which we see as a major problem in sort of the acute energy insecurity that occurs. So stuff like energy democracy, the desire to have more sort of community support of each other, whether that is having hubs for people to go, whether that is checking on each other, whether that is sort of having like strong social networks for support was very important to people. Having clean air and households that are healthy is another major pillar that we've talked about. And so all of these things that culminated into our Northern Manhattan Climate Action Plan was a result of directly what our community members told us, which we think is sort of the ideal way of achieving environmental justice solutions is knowing that community knows the answers to the problem.
And that idea of intersections of both the ways our environment affects us as well as the intersections of our communities, I think is really important. So Nolan, thank you for bringing that up. And I think that communities are not thinking of climate mitigation and climate adaptation at odds is one of the issues that folks like the administration are looking at. So in the interest of moving us towards the end, because we have a little bit of time, Margaret and I thought we'd do a little fun exercise. I'm going to pass it to Margaret to talk again about this change in administration.
Yeah, I wonder, Carlos, if we should take a few audience Q&A instead. We're only at 5 minutes left. Would that be okay with folks if we move to just some questions from the audience? Okay.
All right.
Okay. Let me just see. We've got a few of them.
We got several.
Yeah, we've had several. So let me pick a couple if that's okay. I want to say one thing first is there's a question here about benefit cost analysis, which Professor Nance brought up. And I want to put a plug in that our next event on our series is going to be about benefit cost analysis. So I think we'll table that question if that's okay. I want to give this, there's a question here for another question for Dr. Nance, though, about the dynamic between different levels of government that you mentioned. And somebody's asking, is this a fundamental flaw in the approach to emergency management, e.g. federally supported, state managed, and locally executed? And what would a different approach look like?
So to me, the structural problem is that all of the federal programs ignore the pressure that local officials have for development. The developers are super powerful from the perspective of the local people. The industries, the developers, they're really controlling and pulling strings, and all of the local policy is to serve them. They're so powerful. And, you know, depending on, like in Houston, the percent of income that oil and gas is such a high percent, they have so much power. And that, you know, that goes on at the local level. Federal programs don't see that. They don't account for that. And so when they put together, let's say they put together a voluntary program, that gives the local official no leverage at all against those powers. So there's, I mean, we could talk for a long time about all of the different ways in which they undermine, just structurally, but that's one example.
Okay.
And certainly one that's played out in Harris County significantly. The next question, I think, is one that speaks certainly to Margaret and my heart around measurement. And issues of how we approach even making decisions. Do we have an infrastructure for measurement to make these decisions more appropriately and more resilient and more equitable overall? So since Dr. Tate has focused so much on vulnerability measures, what do you think of what we're doing right now in federal government and local government in terms of actually making these priorities transparent?
Yeah, so we've... Essentially, there's a newfound massive demand for measures to inform policy and resource allocation, but it's just not something that we've invested in as a nation to build these sort of measures or even understand underlying processes, right, about discrimination and marginalization and history and injustice. And so there's this immediate need, but we don't really know what we're doing. So I think we just need a sustained long-term effort in terms of, you know, working with communities, understanding processes, making better models and measures, implementing those, integrating those into policy and practice is a long-term thing.
If I can ask all the panelists, Margaret, so certainly Justice 40 is what the WEJAC, the White House Environmental Justice Advisory Council has been charged with. How do we do that in climate context when we're looking at it? Projected exposure and vulnerability. I'm going to start with Dr. Nance.
Well, that's a big question. I don't have an immediate answer to it. It's there's so much. It's like you're holding up the whole world. There's so much. I don't know the answer to that. But I do know that a lot of our measures have so much in them. They're just chock, it's like a kitchen sink of stuff, and then you get an index. And so it's hard to communicate to the community what that means. So I think that our indexes need to be simplified. I just developed a simplified index for Harris County for measuring flood equity. 3 measures, that's it. Everybody can do it. You can do it at your kitchen table. Just make the data available to everyone and they can do it. So it should be like that. It should be simple, something on your phone. Something where people can touch it and understand it. I think that's an important thing.
That's great. And I should note, Margaret, that a lot of questions came in about, can people have access to the documents and the resources that all four of you have been discussing? So we will be,
we've had this request before, and we'll try to meet that need. And I think Dr. Nance held up a document, so she needs to give us the link, and really would really ask our panelists to perhaps share one or two items that would help folks kind of get their hands around some of this stuff. But we'll do our best to post that on the website. I see that we are now at 12 o'clock Eastern, so I think we're going to have to end. This always happens where we have too much to talk about in an hour, but so anyway, I want to bring it to a close by thanking you all for joining us and for your very thoughtful questions. And this event, again, I'll say is recorded, and you can watch it or rewatch it in full at rff.org, where you can also find out more about subscribing to our other content and supporting RFF. And finally, thanks so much to our wonderful speakers for joining us. We really, really appreciate them. Carlos and I were so excited to get this group today. If you can see links to their bios and their recent work on the website link for this event. So have a great day, everyone, and thanks again for joining us.
Thank you, everyone.